Thanks for joining us for Celebration of Worship. First United Methodist Church is a welcoming community of faith that strives to be a place where everyone can belong, believe, and become a blessing. At First United Methodist Church, you can come just as you are to grow in your desire to know Christ, as well as discover your own unique way of making the world a better place at 201 Monroe Street in Jefferson City. We hope you enjoy today's message.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church. It is wonderful to have you here for our 8:30 worship service. We are very blessed by your presence, very blessed by the bell choir. You know, it is a real gift for our church to be led in worship by the bell choir, a blessing that so many other churches don't necessarily get to experience, and we're very thankful to God for everyone who participates in that. If you're interested in taking part in the bell choir, I know they would love to have you be a part of it. Please just speak with a member of the choir or with Keith and myself or Ryan or Bill, and we're happy to get you connected in that way. I want to give a special word of welcome to those of you who may be guests with us this morning. If you are here for the first time or second or third time, welcome. We're really grateful to God that you're here. You make the morning very special. And I want to say good morning as well, or good evening or whatever, to those of you who are watching on TV and watching on the internet too. We thank you for participating in that way as well. My name is Daniel Hilty. I'm one of the pastors here. And today we're wrapping up actually our series that was supposed to be wrapped up before the season of Lent. Today is the first weekend of Lent. For those of you who aren't familiar with Lent, it's the season we observe in the church. It's 6 weeks long of getting ready ourselves for Jesus' crucifixion on Good Friday, his resurrection on Easter morning. We call that season of getting ready Lent. And you may remember a few weeks ago we had an ice storm, right, that kind of interrupted things. So everything was delayed by a week. So we're wrapping up our pre-Lenten series today, and we're getting more into our Lenten series next weekend. Whatever weekend we're on, I'm glad you're here for it, and I want to ask you to please join with me in a moment of prayer as we begin our sermon. Let's pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for this morning and the opportunity to be together in worship on a lovely day. We thank you, Lord, for your spirit that comes to us in music and in fellowship, in words spoken and heard, in the thoughts of our minds and the meditation of our hearts. Oh Lord, we pray that you would please be in all of this this morning. Be in our speaking, our sharing, our hearing. Be around our communion table. Use all of it, oh Lord, to draw us closer to you and to Jesus Christ, through whom we pray. Amen. So Keith mentioned earlier, this is the last week in our Discovering Joy series. And if you've been here the last couple months, you may remember that the idea behind the series is that we've tried to highlight different spiritual practices that we can engage in to help us discover joy in our lives, or the joy of the Lord in our lives. In a way, what we've been trying to do in this series is to give us a kind of joy toolbox, right? This is the extent of the tools I'm comfortable with, by the way. I need to let you know, my son has far surpassed me in this department. But we've been trying to give ourselves kind of a joy toolbox, right? And inside this joy toolbox, we've attempted to put different kinds of tools, different kinds of instruments that can nurture joy in our lives, help us discover the joy of God in our lives. And so, for example, the first week we talked about the importance of curiosity. Remember, we talked about potatoes, professors, and puppies, right? And how the more we allow God to teach us something new every day, the more that helps to nurture joy in our lives. Even learning something from the difficult places in our lives, for example. The second week, we talked about service and how reaching out to others in their pain with the love of Jesus Christ can help us in our pain and our hurt, and to realize that we're not alone either. The third week, we talked about recreation and how taking time for doing what is unnecessary in the eyes of the world can allow God to help recreate our own souls in a way. And then the fourth week, we discussed how God has given us all the power to forgive, which really is the power to set people free, other people and ourselves, in the name of Jesus Christ. Well, today we're looking at the final and what I believe to be the most effective tool in our toolbox for discovering joy, and that is gratefulness. Gratefulness. David Steindl-Rast is a Benedictine monk, and he puts it like this. He says that the root of joy is gratefulness. The root of joy is gratefulness. It is not joy that makes us grateful, he says. It's gratitude that makes us joyful. And if there's one quote I hope we can maybe keep with us from this series, I guess this would be it. That it's not joy that makes us grateful. It's gratitude that makes us joyful. In other words, the more grateful we are, the more we discover joy in our lives. And fortunately for us, gratefulness is a really easy tool to learn to use in our joy toolbox, right? In fact, if all of these practices are different tools in our toolbox here, gratefulness would be the hammer, right? Gratefulness would be the hammer. Specifically, gratefulness would be the toy hammer in the hands of a toddler. Now, what do I mean by that? Here's what I mean. Who can tell me what happens when you give a toy hammer to a toddler? Will that toddler limit their hammering just to the toy nails that comes with the toy toolbox? No, right? They will not exhibit such self-control, right? They may hammer on the toy nails, right, for a little bit, but then, you know, that's really fun, so why not hammer on a few other things too, right? Like the coffee table, right? Or like maybe the cat, right? Or maybe the father's head, right? If you're a toddler with a hammer, your whole view of the world changes because all of a sudden, everything is a nail, right? Everything is a nail, right? If you're a toddler and you're actively looking for things to hit with your hammer, you will find that the world is filled with things that you can hit with your hammer, right? And the same is true with gratefulness. Because if we're actively looking for things to be grateful for, we will also find a whole world of things to be grateful for. And I know of no other place in the Bible that expresses that truth better than Psalm 136. Psalm 136 is our scripture reading for today. And it is biblical practice for how to find reasons to be grateful that are all around us. Psalm 136 teaches us that gratefulness is like a toy hammer, right, in the hands of a toddler. The more we look for places to use it, the more we look for places to employ our gratefulness and put it to work, the more we will find places where we can. And Psalm 136 teaches us that lesson through the power of one especially catchy chorus, which brings us to these guys. So who can tell me what dance these guys are doing? The YMCA, of course. The YMCA dance is a hugely popular dance, right? You know, the YMCA. They do it at sporting events, and they do it at roller skating rinks, and they do it at parties. I understand it's even been performed on the space shuttle, right? So somewhere up there in the sky overhead some night, someone's doing the YMCA, right? But in case you are not familiar with the YMCA, here is a brief video by our Green Crayon Youth Ministry team to introduce us.
Young man?
Yeah, me.
That sounds right.
Stop.
They do a good job. I love our youth ministry team. I especially love the ending of that, you know, because have you noticed that a lot of people, for the most part, really do only know the chorus of YMCA, right? Have you noticed? I know that's true for me, right? Whenever I try to sing along with the verses, I'm like Max, right, in the penguin suit in the video. I know that it starts off with young man, right? But then I kind of trail off after that, right? You know, young man, da 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 da, young man, da, YMCA, right? And maybe you're the same way with YMCA, or maybe if you don't know YMCA that well, you make relate to that feeling from other songs you hear on the radio, right? Or praise choruses from church or different hymns, you know, that we remember the choruses, but we forget the verses, right? Now, why is that? Why do we only sing along with the choruses on songs like that? Well, because, you know, it's easy to understand it. Those choruses are very short and they're very easy to remember, right? They're short and they're easy to remember. If we want something to get stuck in our brains, we make it short and we make it easy to remember. When a chorus is short and easy to remember, there's no problem singing along with it. In fact, sometimes we can't help but sing along, right? Because it gets in our heads And even if we want to, we can't get it out, right? YMCA. You're going to be singing that all day, right? Right? And that's what makes Psalm 136 such a powerful tool for teaching us to be grateful. Because, as some of you may know already, the Psalms were actually written to be sung, right? The Psalms were written to be sung. They're like an ancient hymn book that's in the Bible. And so these were the hymns and the praise songs of the ancient Hebrew people. And of all of those songs, all of those psalms, Psalm 136 is especially catchy, right? Psalm 136 is like the YMCA of ancient Bible songs. It is. And so because it has this chorus that it's actually more like a refrain, but it just repeats itself again and again and again, right? Like YMCA, YMCA. It's short, it's easy to remember, and because of that, it can get inside of our brains. And so to help me read today's passage from Psalm 136, I'd like your help, please. I'd like you to read the repeated part, please, the refrain. And it's really easy. Your part is simply, God's love never quits, right? Just four parts, right? Like YMCA, right? God's love never quits. Can you say that with me, please? God's love never quits. Thank you. So, that's your part. Whenever you see it on the screen, please read it with gusto, okay? Can you read it with gusto? Because remember, this is the YMCA of Bible songs, right? So this is how it goes. Psalm 136 starts off like this. Thank God. God deserves your thanks. And everyone says, I can hear the gusto. Good job. Thank the God of all gods. Thank the Lord of all lords. Thank the miracle-working God. And then Psalm 136 starts listing examples of everything we have to be thankful for. Just a few examples all around us. It says, the God whose skill formed, you know, the cosmos. The God who laid out earth on ocean foundations. The God who filled the skies with light. The God who put the sun to watch over the day. Moon and stars as guardians of the night. And then it wraps it all up by saying, finally, God takes care of everyone in their time of need. Thank God who did it all. Thank you. Thanks for your help with the reading. So, you know, you can imagine if you did this over and over again for a while, right? And then on repeated occasions over weeks and months and years or whatever, God's love never quits could kind of get stuck in your head, right? It is kind of like the YMCA of ancient Bible songs. And getting God's love never quits stuck in your head isn't necessarily a bad thing, right? There are worse things that could get stuck in a person's head than God's love never quits. Can you imagine what it would be like to go through the day and to have that continuously running through your mind? Something bad happens and your brain says, well, God's love never quits. Something good happens and your brain says, well, God's love never quits. Can you imagine just how much more grateful we might feel, right, as we go through our day? Can you imagine how that would put everything in a new light? Because to a toddler with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And to a person who sees the world through the lens of a God whose love never quits, everything, or at least almost everything, might look like a reason to give thanks to. And the truth is, we can practice gratefulness in any circumstance, in any place in life, no matter how hard, no matter how tragic. It doesn't mean we give thanks to God for those things that tear apart lives. It doesn't mean that God wanted them. It means that there are seeds of blessing in spite of all the bad, in almost everything. I remember a story that a friend once told me about his father. For a long period of time, my friend's father was in the hospital. And for days, this father of my friend was unresponsive. He could not communicate. The folks around him had no idea, right, if he had any sense of anything that was going on around him, right? He was just in the hospital bed for days and days. Well, eventually, my friend's father recovered, right? And he got strong again. He got up again. He got out of the hospital. He returned to a normal life. And when his family asked him about that time when he was unresponsive, when they weren't sure if he knew anything that was going on around him, when he could not communicate, when they asked him about that time, he said, "I was conscious during that whole time, I believe," he said. He said, I was alert, and I could hear, and I could think. And his family was shocked, right? His family was shocked, and they said, "You know, what did you do during all that time? How could you stand it?" "Well, what I did," my friend's father said, was "I prayed," right? "I prayed. And every time I breathed in, I said to myself, Jesus Christ is in me. And every time I breathed out, I said to myself, the Holy Spirit surrounds me. Jesus Christ is in me. The Holy Spirit surrounds me. And that saw me through," my friend's father said, "because even there, God never left me. And that's how I remembered it. God's love never quits, right? God's love never quits." That's how my friend's father made it through. That's how he maintained a grateful heart, right? By remembering throughout it all that God's love never quits. And that's the good news for you and me today, too. That's the final good news of this series. Whatever you are going through in life, God's love never quits. No matter how good or how bad life may seem, God's love never quits. And the one thing we can always be grateful for, no matter what, is, can you say it with me, please? God's love never quits. One more time, please. God's love never quits. Thanks. And to help us remember that, we have one final prayer card to send home with you that you can pick up today, either at the communion tables or on your way out today. They're on the pillar, stool by the pillar as you leave. The prayer that is printed on the cards is also on the screen. And as we close the sermon today, will you please pray with me? Oh God, whatever this day may hold, help me remember that your love never quits. Let me view more of the world around me through the lens of gratefulness, that I may see your love shining through and grow in your joy. In Christ's name. Thank you.